Hi, I'm Sandesh Mundra, and in this short video series that is being created by the Bombay Chartered Accountant Society, I've taken up the topic of renting of immovable property. Now, if we just go back to the pre-GST period, we would note that it all started with a controversy. The government wanted to collect service tax on renting, treating it as service per se. But then finally, the matters went to the court. Delhi High Court in Home Solutions had held that renting cannot be a service. And then, as usual, there was an amendment. A deeming fiction was introduced, and the government had the upper hand, and they started collecting service tax as far as the renting of immovable property is concerned. So with all this controversy getting settled, we finally come to the GST regime. The GST regime almost has got many parallels as far as renting is concerned when we compare to the pre-GST regime. Renting per se has been defined. It would include licensing, it would include letting, it would include leasing, whether with or without possession, with or without control. So a very wide definition has been given to the word renting. So if, as a user, I may camouflage my transactions by treating them as lease or license or some other way, but the manner in which the word has been defined, it would encapsulate all such transactions and tax each and everything under the broad heading of renting of immovable property. Now, whenever we look at the nature of service, we would also have to ascertain what are the different kind of exemptions which have already been given by the government under this renting of immovable property. So the first exemption which has been given is as far as renting of an agricultural vacant land is concerned. So if I have an agricultural land and if I give it on lease or on rent to anyone, that transaction is exempt. Second, and probably the most critical exemption, is about renting of residential dwelling. So if I have a property and if I give it to someone only for the purpose of their residence and there is no commercial angle attached to it, then that transaction is also exempt. Apart from that, renting of precincts of a religious place has also been exempted under GST. In pre-GST also you had this exemption, and government has more or less tried to carry over the exemptions which existed, and that is why this renting of precincts of a religious place has also been exempted under the GST regime. Then there are two exemptions which are not of use to a common man, but for the sake of information, let me just put it up, that renting of properties by Reserve Bank of India or renting of property by government to a non-business entities have also been covered under this exemption list. The threshold is the normal threshold which is applicable to everyone. So if I have a property somewhere in India, if my gross turnover is 20 lakhs or below that, I am not required to take any registration. But the moment my turnover exceeds 20 lakhs, then I will be required to take a registration. And this threshold would not only include, for example, if I have a commercial property given on rent where I enjoy a rent of 15 lakhs, and if I have a residential property which is given on rent where I enjoy a rent of, let's say, 10 lakhs, because I breach the threshold of rupees 20 lakhs, on the value of 15 lakhs, I will be required to pay GST. The value of 10 lakhs will be an exempted turnover. But because I breached the 20 lakhs threshold, it will compel me to take a registration. One issue as far as registration is concerned is that if I have properties in 3 or 4 different states of the country, do I need to go and take a separate registration in each of these states? I may be a resident, let us say, of Maharashtra, Mumbai, but if I have properties in Karnataka, if I have properties in Delhi, do I take a separate registration there? My view is that it is not required. From the state where, which is my usual place of residence, I can do a billing to all these respective states and I can avoid taking registration in these respective states. As far as the place of supply is concerned, there is a very specific rule under the place of supply mechanism which says that if the place of supply is in relation to an immovable property, it will always be the place where this immovable property is located. Now, this can lead to some interesting scenarios. For example, if I have a property in Goa, I am based in Maharashtra, and if I rent it out to a company which is based, let us say, in Chennai, and there is a broker who helps me getting this customer to whom I have to pay a brokerage. Now what happens? The broker, let us say, is based in Goa. He may bill to me because I am based in Maharashtra. But since the services are in relation to immovable property, he will bill to me saying that the place of supply is Goa. And if I don't take a registration in the state of Goa, I'll end up losing that credit. So place of supply in relation to immovable property will always lead to some scenarios where your credit gets stuck up in the location where the properties are located. So then it may as well make sense to go and register in each of these locations where my property is located. But then one has to take a call and balance out the pros, cons and the benefits attached in taking a registration and the compliances and the costs involved in taking that registration. As far as input tax credit is concerned, if I am billing renting services to any corporate client, then the corporate client will obviously be able to take the input tax credit related to those services, as these services are not under the blocked credit list. But the only interesting issue is that if I myself get the building constructed and if I have to lease it out, if I sell out the building, then the complete credit flow is there and I am able to take the credit. But because I want to venture out into leasing rather than selling out the buildings, the credit gets blocked. So I think this is one of the issues which can be taken up for representation to the government, because this is a huge cost impact and a huge working capital impact for all those developers who have started venturing out into the business of leasing. Now let's come to some of the controversies as far as this leasing is concerned. One very critical controversy which has been doing rounds is about long-term lease. So if I enter into a long-term lease arrangement, let us say a 50-year lease arrangement of a land or a property, and I'm also subjected to stamp duty and the registration under the local stamp duty and the registration laws, am I or will I also be subjected to GST? If I go to the exemption list, I will find that there is one exemption for one-time upfront lease premium if the lease is for more than 30 years or more than 30 years, and the lease is given by any state industrial undertaking corporation to an industrial unit. So then, as far as the residential dwelling is concerned, the benefit was only for the residential dwellings and not for commercial dwellings. But as far as the long-term lease is concerned, it is exactly vice versa, because the benefit is only for industrial undertakings, for the industrial units. Now the view which needs to be judged and which needs to be looked at, because it will have serious cost implications: if I enter into a 99 years lease, can I say that this is equivalent to a sale transaction and not a typical lease which is subjected to GST? Let's go back to the history of India and let us see how India got independence. Because when all these princely states in India were getting consolidated through the help and through the efforts of some of our freedom fighters, these princely states kept in some conditions for getting merged into India. A lot of instruments of accessions were signed into, and some of these princely states put up a condition that the land will always be in my name, and if the government wants to transact, it can do it by way of a lease. And this is how you had leasing getting into, and you had some portions of our country where you could only lease the land and virtually transfer was ruled out because of all these instruments of accession. Now when the government disregards this history and says that we will only go by the legal form, that if the legal form of the transaction is transfer, then it is out of, because government believes that I am at the mercy of Schedule 3, which says that sale of land and building is the only item which is under the negative list. But I believe that a 99 years lease would also fall into the domain of an immovable property, and it is in substance the transfer of that land. So I will disregard the form of the transaction and I will go with the substance of the transaction, because I also need to look at the history behind that particular land. If the government of a state says that this portion of the land will never be transferred, will only be available on lease, then why do we tax these transactions just going by the form? So that is controversy one. You recently even had a Mumbai High Court judgment which is negative, but when you read this judgment you will find that all the issues and deliberations which have taken place in that judgment have not been given, have not taken into consideration all the factors which should have been taken into consideration. So probably the judgment will be reviewed and even challenged before the apex court. But till then, yes, you will have to live with that controversy. Some of the companies may feel that let us pay tax if we are getting the credit. But then I would not suggest such a practice, because in future, such stands which you have taken may have an implications on your other projects or other businesses. The second issue which we recently had a circular was about the tenancy premium. Now, what is a tenancy premium? If I am a tenant of a particular property, I have a right to buy the tenancy rights for a long-term duration. And if I pay an upfront premium to the owner of the property, the owner gives me a tenancy right, which is transferable in nature, and I can even transfer it to some other buyer. People sought clarification that these transactions of tenancy premiums are subjected to stamp duty. These are subjected to payment of registration fees under the state local laws. How can they again be subjected to GST? So the government has given a pro-revenue view here also, just like you had in case of a long-term lease, that just because these transactions are subjected to stamp duty or registration fees, it doesn't mean that these are not service. You could have multiple aspects to a single transaction, and the aspect of service is what is taxed. The aspect of transfer is taxed under the state law, and it is the aspect of service which is involved is taxed under the GST law. But there's very one interesting observation which I could see in this circular. The government says that because you have renting of residential dwelling which is exempted, so if the tenant who is residing there procures this tenancy rights by paying a tenancy premium, they would have the same color as the renting of residential dwelling and would be exempted under GST. But if the tenant transfers it to some other tenant, or if the tenant procures some amount of money for vacating that property, then those transactions will be taxed. Now, if we closely look at this particular finding and this particular circular, can I say that government has extended the exemption of residential dwelling to the tenancy premium also, because they felt that they are of the same color? So when we look at the transaction of a development right and a sale of land, can we not take the same view that a development right ultimately is equivalent to, or the value is totally derived from the value of land? So I am slightly moving away from my topic, but then I saw that and I could feel that this particular observation could have an implication on other real estate transactions also. The third thing which we saw, and which was a controversy which is now settled, is that about one-third deduction which is available in case you are a builder and you are transferring land along with the property. This deduction was earlier not available to a leasehold land. And now, thankfully, in that notification which mentions about the one-third deduction, that particular explanation refers to all the entries, whether it is affordable housing or whether it is other housing projects or other works contracts where land is involved. And if as a builder I am doing a project on a leasehold land, it would not mean that I am disentitled to that one-third deduction. Even if I am doing it on a leasehold land, I would still be entitled to that one-third deduction. So I think this sums up the basic issues as far as renting of immovable property is concerned. Thank you.